H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Shobhan, I guess before you start, will you cover the assignment that you gave yesterday? I just was not able to do that assignment, so.
No, I'll not cover the assignment. What I'm going to do is I'll give you an idea how to do it. I want you guys to try a few more times before I give you the solution. So I'll just tell you, the logic, how to build that logic, and then you have to try by yourself.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So just give a few more tries. If you're not able to do it, then I'll help you, okay? But today I'll tell you the logic. So before doing that, so today we'll take up a few more easy transformations. Let me just really quickly see. Okay, today we'll see the sequence generated transformation. And let's first take sequence generated transformation, then we'll see. So what I'm going to do is I will again create another copy of the same mapping. So it's filter transformation, copy this. Or not the sorter, sorry. So how do we rename the mapping? This is how we rename the mapping. So I want to remove the sorter and want to make it sequence generator. Okay. Now. Transformation create. Sequence generator. Let's create one more port here. So this is a very interesting transformation. I'll tell you the details. Let me first run and show you the output. No, I'm not talking right now, so that's why you're not able to hear me. Okay, let's just run this file and see what we get. Okay, now let's see, this is very important. When you see it failed, right? So how do you know why it failed? The first place I would like to see what the reason for the failure is this one. So it says, you see, error opening the file, see this. So that means this path is not correct or the file name is not correct. And I'm looking to that, I can see the path is not correct. So I'll go and change the path here. Now let's rerun it. Okay, it ran and it generated 34 records. And let's see how that the records. Okay. Now, the serial number is not showing, okay, because I did a sorting based on this thing. Okay, hold on. Yeah. So, if you look at the serial number, see, this is the serial number, 1, 2, 3, 4, and this part is your employee number, right? This part is your employee number. So, what we can do is to make it more readable, what we can do is, let's see one thing. So this is a telephone, everything is left justified. So employee full name is left justified, right, and it is justified. Okay, so if you look to the output, you will see that this is your output, right? The serial number, if you look at this first column, which is nothing but your serial number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, okay. Now, what I'm going to do is, I will just rerun this. I'll just rerun it one more time. Now, after rerunning, if you look to my sequence number, the sequence number changed. It started from 35, 36, 37, 38, and then 68, right? The reason is, let's fix this. The reason is, now if I go to my sequence generator and properties, you will see few things here. So let's go here and then you'll see, understand better. So let's see my sequence generator here. Okay. So let's do one thing. See? If you look to my sequence generator here in the session, it says the current value is 69, start value is 0, incremented by 1. Okay. So now next time when I run the session one more time, you will see the count will start from 69. sorry. See, count started from 69. And this current value will again change. If you go here, you will see the current value has changed. Current value has changed to 103. So if I go into my mapping, let's disconnect and connect one more time. And let's see this. So if I go and look into my mapping, you'll see the current value has changed. So what I want to do is, I don't want to change my current value every time it runs. So what I want to do is, I'll make the current value as 1, and I'll do a reset. So that means every time when you run it, you reset these values. So now, when I'm running this, okay. Now when I'm running this, let's see what happens. See, the number again started from 1, right? 1 to 34. Now let's do one. Let's again run it one more time. Started from again 1 and ended at 34. So if you check this box reset, then it will reset the values every time it starts running. Okay. Now incremented by is, right now it's incremented by 1. So that's why you are seeing the value 1, 2, 3, 4. If I make the increment by value as 2, you will see the values are 1, 3, 5, 7, like that. So let's just see 1, 3, 5, 7, and so depending upon the value what you put in the incremented by, the values will be incremented, okay? And then if you want to cycle the values, let's say I have a data for 12 months data and they are coming in a row. That means first row is for month of January, second row is month of February, and so on. 12th row is for month of April. And again comes the first 13th row is month of January. So for each account, I am getting 12 values, but each not in column, but in rows. So if I want to mark them like 1 to 12, 1 to 12, 1 to 12, what I have to do is, I'll be doing like 12, and then I'll do a cycle. And so that way, it will start the value from 1 to 12, and then again 1 to 12, 1 to 12, 1 to 12. That's how it will cycle the values. So any questions for me? These are the different properties of your, yeah, go ahead. Hello, someone has a question?
Yeah. So in the ports, can you go back to the ports again?
Where?
The ports, you know, in the input output ports in this transformation sequence generator.
Can I see the ports?
it's taking time. Okay, now it's open. So both the values are creating an output here?
No. Right now just concentrate on NextVal, because right now I have connected only NextVal. I'll come to CarVal, but
I'll I got confused there.
Ask me the questions whichever I have covered until now. So any doubt, any questions? I'll come to CarVal. Okay, so if I connect the CarVal, so right now, so if you look to the sequence generator transformation, it does not have any input port, only output port. So if I connect the CarVal, what happens is it will populate only the current value. So it will not populate the next value. So that means whatever I have assigned as a current value, let's say if I assign and 10 as a current value, it will just keep on replicating the same 10 34 times. Ten. So CarVal is nothing but the current value assigned into the assigned for the sequence generator transformation. So now if we go back to our yesterday's assignment, one part of the assignment is very easy. You can do it through a sequence generator transformation, but the other part is not possible through sequence generator transformation. That means, where is the assignment? Hold on. Yeah, this is the assignment. Okay. Now, if you look to this assignment, this serial number, first serial number is very easy to generate using the sequence generator. But the complex part is your second sequence number. Now, I'll tell you two more concepts today which will help you to do the assignment number 3. Okay. Now, until now, in expression transformation, whatever we have seen is only the input port and the output port. There is one more port which is called a variable port. So variable port is a temporary storage and which is local to that expression. Local to the expression means this port is not accessible to by any other transformation. So if you look to my output port, so I have so many output ports. When I minimize this, you can see that all the output ports are available and I can connect it to the next transformation. But just now I created one variable port, which is, let's say, where, but this port is not available to connect to the other transformations. So that means this port, I can use this port only within this expression transformation. Variable ports are basically an intermediate storage place. So for example, what I can do is I can use this expression, control X, in my variable port, variable here. So this is my intermediate storage place, and what I'm doing is I can write down VAR. So what I'm doing is I have created one variable port where I'm doing the intermediate calculations for the phone number and then assigning that value to the phone, which is my output port. Any doubt, any question on this concept? Okay. Now, two things. for this assignment, you have to use a variable port, and I'll just give you the concepts how will you use the variable port. But try to do this assignment even for the first serial number also. Don't use the sequence generator. Try to use a variable and try to generate this sequence number within the expression transformation and connect it. So now coming back to the second serial number. So how do I do that? Is the concept is something like this. What I have to do is I have to do a sorting on my data based on the department ID, so that all the department's IDs which are same will be together. Now I will create two variables. One variable will be to capture the previous value, and one variable will be used to capture the current value. So let's say I declare a variable, let's say previous department, and then let's say V underscore previous department, and then I will create another variable which is V underscore current department. Okay, and then I will create another variable which is called count. Now, let's just think my data is like this. 10, 10, and then 20, 20, 20. This is how my data looks. Okay. Now, what I'll do is, when Informatica will read the first record, what I'm going to do is, at the beginning, like at the time, first time when Informatica is reading the first record, I'll assign the previous record, previous department as 0, my current department I'll assign it as 10, and my count will be assigned is maybe 0, let's say 0. So this is what is, or maybe let's say 1, my count will be 1. Now next, when Informatica will read the next record, what I'm going to do is I will assign the previous department ID, which is 10. Okay, now in the count, I will have to write a condition something like this. If this is equal to this, then count is equal to count plus 1, else count equal to 0. So let's say 1. So this syntax, practically, this is not correct. I'm just giving you the logic. Okay, so don't try to just copy and paste the same code. No, syntax. I'm giving you the logic. So syntax, you have to check and how you have to check how you can implement it. So after my first record is read, what I'm going to do is I'll put the previous department department ID is equal to 10, and current department ID is also 10. And what I'm going to do is I will increase the count value by 1. So that means now my count becomes 2. Now when Informatica is reading the third row, what I'm going to do is I'll make the previous department ID as 10 and current department ID as 20. And this condition will not become true, so my count will become again 1. So that's how you have to implement. Now Informatica how Informatica reads data is, this is the order, okay, whatever is order declared here in the expression, Informatica will read the order of the columns row by row, okay. So any questions, anyone who couldn't understand the concept, how to implement this? Okay, so that means I can hope that this assignment should be done by next class, right? Because everyone understood this concept. So try this.
Hello?
If you are not able to implement. Yeah.
Yeah, this is Tunde.
Yeah.
In real life scenario,
mm-hmm.
What kind of situation do we use this kind of a transformation?
See, expression transformation is a very, expression transformation is a transformation which is used for any kind of calculations. So I know you have missed the first class, so I will cover these things into on Sunday's class. Hold this question and ask me then, okay?
Okay, okay.
Because I am going to go in details about the expression transformation in Sunday's class. One more time.
Okay. Okay,
thank you. Yeah, no. So, any questions for me? No? Okay. So this is...
Shubhan, I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Logic with count. How the value of count is helping in that logic?
What is your question? Yeah, tell me, what is your question?
It is like changing either to 2 or either coming back to 1. What is the logic of count? How is it helping there?
This count? This one? Hello? Hello.
Yes, I can hear you, Shoman. Hello.
Yeah. So hello. Your question is how this count is helping me?
Yeah.
See, if you look to my assignment, this count is the count I'm populating here. So I gave you the logic how to populate these counts, these numbers. So that is nothing but the count which I am calculating there. Got it?
Okay, okay, I get it, yeah.
And this is a very, very, very common scenario, because what happens in real-time scenario is when you read data from any source, you may have to compare the records, okay? It's not the comparing columns. Comparing columns is very easy, but comparing records is very tough. So here, this is how you compare the records. So if you can implement this logic, you will know how do we compare the records, okay? So now today we'll do a little bit of theory. I was telling yesterday about the data modeling overview. Sorry, not the data modeling overview. Sorry. Now let's understand, let me again go back to the concept of OLTP and OLAP, and then I'll come back to what is dimensional modeling and what is relational modeling and how dimensional modeling is different from relational modeling and why do we use dimensional modeling in data warehouse world, okay? So to define the OLTP and OLAP in nutshell is whatever transactions you do in your daily life, those are all OLTP transactions, OLTP transactions. So that means, let's say you go to a bank and swipe your debit card to withdraw money, that is an OLTP transaction. You go to a grocery store, swipe your card to pay, do the payment, that is an OLTP transaction. You go to online, buy your airline tickets, that is OLTP transaction. You go to online and buy stuff from Amazon.com, that is OLTP transaction. So apart from, these are all monetary transactions I'm talking about, but apart from monetary transactions also, let's say I want to go online in my account and I want to see something, not doing any monetary transactions, but just doing, let's say I want to go to Amazon.com and I'm searching for some specific laptop. So that is also a transaction. That is because I'm submitting some query to Amazon.com and Amazon.com is returning a result to me. So that is again a transaction, but that transaction may not involve a monetary thing, but it's a transaction. So all these things are nothing but OLTP transactions. The important part of OLTP transaction you have to understand is the prime focus is to return the rows as early, like as fast as possible. That means in the whole idea is to make my search as fast as possible. So let's think of this. You went to a bank, you swiped your debit card, and you want to withdraw $2,000, but your account has only $1,000. So immediately, it will throw an error saying that you don't have enough balance. Now, so that means at the back end, when you swipe the card, there is a process which is going to your account, looking for that balance present in your account, and then it's checking what amount you want to withdraw, and it does the calculation that it is possible or not, right? Now, this all this process has to happen maybe in 15, 20 seconds, maximum 30 seconds, not more than that, right? Because you just swiped your card and you are waiting for 10 minutes to see that whether you can withdraw the money or not, that's not acceptable, right? So same thing for all the OLTP transactions. The whole idea is my search should be faster. And that is why you design the tables in a relational modeling. Well, in relational modeling, my idea is to make the search faster, okay? Now, let's come back to my analytical OLAP system. Now, in OLAP system, what happens is I have a data warehouse which is storing a data maybe for the last 2 years, 3 years of data. And what I'm trying to do is I want to run a report which will tell me that, okay, show me the performance of all the stores, or let's say Walmart. Okay, so show me the performance of all the Walmart stores in different locations week-wise, or let's say month-wise, for the last 3 years. And also maybe within that store, show me the top 10 products sold by each store. Okay. So this is something in where I have to do, so to process my data in that format, what I have to do is I have to read all the transactional data for which is already stored in my data warehouse for the last 2 years data. And then what I have to do is I have to read for those last 2 years data and then group by the data based on the locations. First group by the data based on the stores and then location. And then maybe the products sold by each location. And then if the reports wants to see, like, okay, show me how much profit is made by each location and how much loss is made by each location, by each store, then I want to do that one also. So basically what you have to understand is my whole purpose of my reporting is to make to prepare a query which is more analytical queries, right? So I'm doing some group by, doing a lot of group bys, and then maybe I'm doing in some aggregation functions, some blah blah, like a lot of analytical functions are working here. So my idea is in this OLAP system is to make my analytical process faster. So in OLAP world, no one will ever run a query like this. Okay, show me this item. Let's say I have item numbers. Let's say I have a TV, television from Samsung, and it has item number 1, 2, 3, 4. So show me which store has sold the item, or maybe show me all the stores which has sold the item number 1, 2, 3, 4. No, most probably in OLAP world, I will not run any queries like that. But there is a possibility in OLAP world, I will run a query like, okay, show me all the stores who are selling TV, television, and then tell me the number of televisions sold by each store by brand, each brand. So getting my point, what I'm trying to say is here, is you are doing the analytical functions more on this data rather than searching. So that's why we design the tables in a dimensional modeling where my analytical process is faster. Getting my point? Any questions for me? Anyone, any question? Okay. So now to do that, the idea of dimensional modeling is we build dimensions and facts. Now what is dimension and what is fact? So dimensions, let's say this is what happens, right? Okay, let me give you an example. Let's say today, Walmart decided that they will build a data warehouse. So now data warehouse is a very big term. So the companies don't decide all of a sudden that they will build a data warehouse. What they decide is they will build a data mart. Now what is the difference between a data mart and data warehouse? Is data mart is basically a small data warehouse which is more focused for a department. So that means, since let's say Walmart decided to build a data mart for the sales department. So this data mart will not have any data from, maybe not have any data from the manufacturer department, maybe it will not have any data from the HR department, maybe it will not have any data from the payroll department, it will not have any data from the logistics department. It will only have data from the sales department. Now, when I'm saying that Walmart is planning to build a data mart for the sales department, that means, and what Walmart will do is he will bring in some few people who are experts, and he will tell that, okay, I want to build a data mart based on my sales department. Now, what happens is, now the people will, like the business analyst and will sit with the Walmart guys and try to understand what exactly is the business. So definitely the Walmart sales business and Verizon sales business and Bank of America sales business and some other company sales business are different, right? So the business analyst has to sit with Walmart and understand what is the retail sales business means. So maybe if this guy, this business analyst, has worked with some other retail company, let's say Target, So this he will have a prior idea. If he has never worked with any retail company, then he will not understand the business very thoroughly. He has to sit with Walmart guys and understand the business. Now there, at that point, along with the business analyst, there will be a team for the data architect team. Now this data architect team will understand the business and they will identify what data will be tagged as dimension data and what data will be tagged as fact data. Now, how do we and we identify what will be the dimension and what will be the fact? Now, anything, any data which defines the characteristics of a business, we tell that as a dimension. Okay, so it's not necessarily characteristics. Definitely the characteristics of the business, also maybe the characteristics of an entity. So that means, let's think of this. So if I'm Walmart guy and I tell you, okay, this is what we do, to tell you a brief about my business, to tell you a brief about the sales business of Walmart, this is what we do. We have a line of products, we have a salesperson, and then what we do is the people come to our store, they select the products, they bring that product to the salesperson, and then salesperson finishes the transaction, the people pay the money and they go out, right? So this is, let's say this is, they say, like this is a high level about my business. So by looking to this information, what I would think is, okay, then probably I would have a dimension, and which is called product dimension. Now this product dimension is nothing but a table which will have all the informations about my products. So this will tell you what are the products sold by Walmart. Now I will have a employee dimension which will tell me the details about the salespersons, not the Walmart corporate persons, but only the sales. So I'll call it as a sales employee dimension. Okay? And then this will give me the details about the employees who worked in that, as a salesperson. Now I will have a, let's say I will have a store dimension. So store dimension will tell me the details about the store. So when I'm saying the details about the store, that means maybe it's a super, super center or not, which location, which zip, which city, which state, blah, blah, blah. Okay? And then, what else? I would probably, I will have a date dimension. And then store dimension, employee dimension, product dimension. More or less this. Let's consider the more or less this. Okay. So what I will do is I will create four tables. One table will called as a product dimension table, and this product dimension table will have one product key and the product description. Then. And a lot of other information, product size, color, blah, 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 all the product information. But important part is I have a product key. Now, I have an employee dimension which says me that this is his employee number, this is first name, last name, phone number, address, blah, 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 all the employee information. Then I have a store dimension which gives me the store ID, store location, and then maybe a super center or yes, no, on which state and blah, 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 all other information. And then I have date dimension. Date dimension is nothing but it's basically the calendar date and which has each calendar date is marked with a key. Okay. Now, so this, I have these four dimension tables. Then I thought like I have to create one fact tables which tells me what transaction happened. So dimension tables, try to understand this. Dimension tables are the tables which defines either the business or the entity, right? Now I created a fact table. This table will tell me the numbers or the measures. So that means every day when people come into the Walmart store and they buy the products, they get a bill, right? So this bill can act as one single row in my fact table. So this is a transaction which gives me the numbers, right? So this is called a fact. Now what I'll do is I'll create a fact table and I will have this fact table connected to all my four dimensions. That means when I go to a store, Walmart store, I buy something, I do a transaction and I come out, there will be an entry in this fact table saying that at this employee 123 has sold a product called XYZ product from the store number 10 on a specific day called maybe June 26 at this time. Got it? So any questions until now?
So fact table, this is Tunde. Mm-hmm. Fact table,
yes,
we
please.
Have all the key from the dimension tables.
Yes, I'll come to the design part like in little bit. But
okay.
just tell me whatever concepts I told you, you understood that or not?
Yes, I understand.
Anyone have any other question? No? Okay. Now, whatever I told, then if I have to design that, it will look like something like this. Okay? So this is a different dimension and fact, but it will be something like this. So I will have different dimension tables from where I will be all the primary keys from the dimensions will be a part of the fact table through which I will connect to the dimensions. And this is called a star schema. Got it? Now, there is another concept which is called a surrogate key. Okay? Now, what a surrogate key is, basically nothing. It's a serial number, auto serial number generated by the system. And why we do this? So, basically, whatever you are looking here, this product dimension ID, right? The product dimension ID would be my surrogate key, and then I will have another column which is called the product ID, which has some meaning. So product ID maybe is the number which you see behind the product. So that's the product ID, but the product dimension key is product surrogate key. So why we use, and then in the fact table also I will have all the surrogate key from the different dimensions and another fact table's own surrogate key. The reason we use the surrogate key is I understand that primary, if I get a duplicate, primary key will not allow me to insert that value. But many of the times, the business is complex and it's very tough to identify all the natural keys and primary keys. So even though we identify the natural keys and primary keys, but when we see the actual data, we see there are duplicates. So if there are duplicates, then the database will not allow to insert those records. That's why we use a surrogate key. So that surrogate key will act as a primary key. Now, even if I have a duplicate data, the surrogate key will allow you to insert that record. And then surrogate key is the key through which you will be connecting from fact table to your dimension table. So that means whenever you pay your bills in Walmart, you get a receipt, and the receipt has, let's say, big number, let's say 10-digit, 12-digit number. So that is a surrogate key for that transaction. Any questions? No. So this is this the schema of design use dimensions and fact tables is called star schema. There is another schema which is called your snowflake schema. Now the snowflake schema, what we do is we normalize the dimension tables. That means we break the dimension tables into more smaller tables. Why we do that? Many of the times we don't want to repeat the same piece of information again and again. So basically, let's say I created a table called which has a zip code and which has the city name attached to it. So zip code and city name. Now what I'll do is, let's say zip code, city name, and some piece of information which is attached to the zip code. Okay. Now I can use the same table for my store dimension, because store should be having some zip code, right? And then I can use the same lookup table for my employee dimension, because when I'm looking for the employee's address, it will have some zip code. So if I don't break that one and make it a separate lookup table, I will be storing the zip and those information in both dimension, in employee dimension and as well as my store dimension. So snowflake schema is similar to your star schema, but what we do is we normalize the dimension tables into more smaller tables which are called lookup tables. Now in real world, at least I have not seen people building pure snowflake or pure star schema. What we do is we do a hybrid schema. So what is a hybrid schema is basically a part will be snowflake, part will be a star schema, and then we connect them. Any questions for me? If you do not have any other question for me, then I want you to read this document, staging area and all this, I'll tell you later. So no need to read the data modeling part, but hold on, at least read this much. So this page, what is this? This is first 10 pages. That way you will understand the concepts very clearly. And come back to me if you have any questions. Next day, I will take up the slowly changing dimensions. Maybe not next day. Later on, I'll take the slowly changing dimension. And then we will also see the staging table concepts and why do we need staging tables and all. Actually, you can go through this document completely. Now you'll understand. Yes, actually you should go through this document. You'll understand and properly what is the concept of dimension facts and how do we identify the dimensions and facts. So no need to read the last two pages, because that is basically the slowly changing dimensions. So until slowly changing dimension, you can read this document. So read until page 34. So any questions for me? Anyone, any question? No. Okay. And then we will keep today's class this much. But
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.